So, we said we had something special today, and the special thing is our first talk today. Sebastian Kurfürst will hold a live talk. So the thing we tried to avoid for the whole conference, it's going to happen now. Many of you probably know Sebastian as a core team member, and he has been for so many years. And what came to mind for me when I thought about introducing him is that he's always thinking about the next big topic he can work on for the NEOS project. Rewriting the backend UI in React? Someone had that idea? That sounds like a good plan. Okay, I'll do it. I'll jump in and help do that. Do a two-day online conference with pre-recorded talks? Yeah, why not? I'll do that. Sounds like fun. So that's Sebastian. Currently, he's neck deep in another huge project, which is the Event Source Content Repository. And he will talk about the current status of the development of that big topic next. So enjoy Sebastian's talk, the Event Source Content Repository.
Hello and welcome from my side as well. I'm really happy to be here on stage at NEOS Conference, and yeah, I'm having the luxury of being the only one who's really talking to an audience, also a small one, at least here in the room, and to all of you guys and girls virtually, and I'm really, really happy to talk to you. Right, so I'm going to share our current progress about the Event Source Content Repository, and I'll also explain a bit about the history of the whole thing and the current status, so that even if you don't really know what this is all about, you'll get a good overview about it. So what is actually this whole thing about? So as you know, NEOS is built of multiple packages. So we have the Flow framework at the bottom, we have NEOS and the NEOS user interface at the top, and in the middle layer, there are three boxes, which we call like the content repository, the asset storage, and also the component for Fusion rendering. And this talk actually will be mostly about the content repository, which is the main storage of our data in the system. If we zoom into that content repository, this is comprised of multiple parts. I don't want to show that in detail here, but actually we have the node type management, we have some public APIs which are displayed in dark blue right here, and everything which is displayed in this light color, like the node data and doctrine and so on, that is all the internals of the content repository. And just by looking at the picture, you see that actually quite some things are going on there. And actually, the current architecture has some a little undesirable properties, which is that the internal structure is not really, really well defined. So we basically grew it as we discovered the features we needed. It is actually somehow slow for bigger node trees, and the performance is somehow harder to predict. And we also have some trouble with orphan nodes sometimes. Some advanced features like history and undo are somehow hard to integrate. And in some cases, we also have hard to reproduce bugs because it's just a complex piece of software. And I'll just show now step by step what we are changing in switching from the current content repository to the new content repository. You don't have to look at it in every single step, but just one by one. So what are we actually doing? First is we are we are making the API more straightforward by splitting the read and the write API apart. We also changed the lower layers. So we introduce a core layer for handling everything related to content dimensions and to workspaces. And as you see, these boxes are dark blue now, which means that they are part of the public API. We also changed the internals of how we store everything. So we're actually using not the doctrine object relational mapper anymore, but just the database abstraction layer. And we are actually making even the database layer itself a public API. And that is one of the most, or that is one of the most important things, because the more stuff we can do in terms of creating public APIs, the easier it is to for you to extend it at points where things won't break. So that means the dimension space and workspace layer is well-defined and sound compared to what we had before. The content graph is optimized for stuff like moving and other complex cases, which we are able to explain right now. And the whole thing is just the basis for advanced features and improving performance step by step. So you don't need to remember all that. It's a big change behind the scenes. And if you visited NEOS conference last year, you might remember these slides. Actually, this is the part which I've also explained last year. I just thought it would be an interesting and a good catch up just for everybody. And the thing is, it doesn't stop here. So that was just what happens in the content repository. But as we change the public API to the outside in some ways, so the API related to writing and reading data, we also need to change the upper layers. So that means NEOS and the NEOS user interface needs some kind of adjustments. And so you see, just by the size of it, it's quite a big, big thing. So the natural question, I think, is why are we actually doing that? So why it's so much work? We are doing that for so many years now. Well, the main reason is that we see huge gains and a very big long-term benefit. Nothing which will pay off in 1 or 2 years, but rather in the terms of like 10 years or something like that. And to understand why is that the case, we have to look at the core of this idea, which is event sourcing. And I'll just explain that next. So if we look at a classical database architecture, we usually have some database and some model in some sense, and we modify and we read it just like that. And if we change to an event-sourced architecture, it actually looks pretty much the same. You just need to have a close look on the labels of the boxes. So that means we, in terms of a database, we use a so-called event store, and in terms of the model, we just use events. So how do these events actually look like? Well, they look like this. So that means they record all user intent, all user actions. So the events could be something like, we want to update some node properties, we want to create, a node was created, some workspace was created, these kind of things. And so that is what we do when we modify the event store. We basically append new events step by step. On the other hand, the reading side is also a little different, which is called a projection. I'll explain that in a second. So that means the write side is actually appending events, and the read side is updating projections. So what is this projection thing? Basically, we have some kind of model in a sense, and there's one side where we just update this model, this projection, and then there's another side where we actually read it. So the easiest thing to imagine is that these are just some database tables, and as we have a new event one by one basically coming in, we update our state step by step. And why is that important? That's for one big reason, which is that actually these projections can be rebuilt. Because remember, we have the event store, which contains the history of everything happening one by one. And so we know what has happened when in the whole system lifetime. And as the projections are just created from this history, we can always throw them away and rebuild them from scratch. So that means we just take our database tables, we'll just kill them, empty them. We apply the first event from the event store, we apply the second one, the third one, fourth one, and so on, until we are at the last point. And at this point, we can actually have the current state again. I'll explain in a bit why this is important. For now, I'd like to follow a user action. So something like, I want to create a node, for instance. So how does that work? The first part of that is actually a so-called command. That is where the user action enters the system. So that's some intent. That's something like, I want to modify something. I want to create a new node. These commands are converted to events. So that's something like that's basically in the past tense. It's the recorded intention, and that is stored in the event store. And as you've just seen this list of events, the basic idea of imagining that is basically just a database table where the events are put in step by step. So really just a big log of everything which has happened. And then we have the read side, so the projection side. And the main projection we are using is something like the content graph. So that's a specialized data structure we use for reading. And basically, the right side is called write side, and the left side is called read side. And basically, that's also the reason why event sourcing is always or often called together with CQRS, because basically this split up between the write and the read side, that is the core idea of CQRS. So what is actually the benefit of that? Because you could imagine all that could be done in a just classical system, but it looks like way overhead. It just looks like very, very much work. And if you build your database models classically, what you try to do is you want to normalize your data. You want to store your data exactly once in the database and not in two or three times, because if you want to update it, you just want to have one place to update. And that's very good for many use cases, but there are some use cases where this actually is bad in terms of performance, in terms of read performance. So, but by splitting that up in the event store, and by making the event store the source of truth, we can actually add additional read sides, additional projections to that. So that means something like we have the content graph, which contains all the tree information. We can have another projection, which contains the infos, which workspace has changes, and we can build arbitrarily new projections in there. And by doing that, we are actually denormalizing our read side, and that way we can actually improve performance quite a lot for many use cases. The main model on the read side is basically the content graph. So that means if you interact with a Node API, you are almost completely interacting with the content graph API internally. And there's just a detail. We have something like soft constraints for checking boundaries, but that's not so important right now. So this architecture has loads and loads and loads of consequences. So the most important one is we know what has happened in the past. So as you've seen in this audit log, we basically know every single state change in the system. And that's a radical departure of the classical way you're building database applications. And actually, we tried to build an audit log. So if you remember this history feature in Neos, that was the idea to build an audit log based on the classical architecture. And we just failed. We're not able to put everything we need into this audit log, for instance, to support stuff like history and undo in a proper way. And the reason, I think, is because our data structure, our content tree, our node tree is quite special. It has quite a lot of features which we need to support. So stuff like workspaces, dimension fallbacks, this general tree idea, that makes it quite hard to build a good data or to build a consistent data model for that. And that is what we have done with the event source content repository. So based on our experiences in the previous years working with the current content repository, we were able to build a sound and consistent concept for all the main interactions, like, as I said, workspaces, content dimensions, the node tree, and stuff like hidden nodes, for instance. And when we have done that, we can actually build features on top of that. So we can start building stuff like a proper history and undo support, for instance. We could build something like editing notifications. So something like if your base language has been modified, for instance, we could tell, well, by the way, you need to change something. in a different language so that the translation becomes up to date again. We can do stuff like synchronization. So that means if you have multiple NEOS instances, because we have this audit log, we are able to send these events to a different server, and this way we can make other systems cooperate with each other. And I think that is a really big important thing if we look at really, really big instances at some point in time. And the core idea about all that is that this is extensible for everybody. So that means it's basically about your ideas and about what you actually build with that. And I mean, if you have been at the NEOS conferences in the last years, you might remember that actually it has been in the making since quite some years. So this is actually, I think, the fourth year we are actually talking about the event sourced something. I just collected some details. So in December 2016, we had the first workshop 4 years ago. With the first ideas with an external consultant called Matthias Veres, and who said, well, you will have quite a lot of work in front of you. And he was actually totally right. But he also said, if we manage to do that, that will be a really important step for us. Then we had various sprints, like in 2017. And at the end of 2017, we actually were able to discover most of the important concepts which are still in place today. And we did the first like baby implementation steps, all very rough, all very small, but just we basically got started in this domain. And then came in Dresden, we worked on that, also continued with a separate sprint. And actually, that was a really cool one because there was some. So that was not just core developers joining the sprint, but also I think Michael Gerdemann from Avensi joined that, and that was really cool because he didn't have any previous event sourcing experience, but he still was able to really help us and did a big contribution in the sprint by creating a very important feature. Then we had NEOS conference in Hamburg. And actually, up to that point, we actually forked NEOS. So we were not able to build this radical new structure inside our current NEOS system, but we basically had to copy everything and then modify what we needed. And we knew that isn't a good feasible way, but we just needed a point to get started somehow. And the whole thing just worked on the demo side. It was not possible at all to use it at custom sites, and it was still this build as ever work stage. Last year, I presented the current state at the NEOS conference in Dresden, and at that point it was no fork anymore, and we were able to publish Alpha 1 version, and we basically knew, okay, this will generally work out. So that's the state since last year, and now I'm going to explain a bit in detail what we actually did since then. So the first important thing was the workspace handling. Beforehand, we just had the concept in mind how we do nested workspaces, and we didn't actually really implement it in the full depth. And by now, we fixed that. So we implemented nested workspaces setup support, and also cleanup routines for stale data. So basically something like, I don't know, Git clean, or I'm not sure how this is called for Git. So that was a really important topic for us because it was one of the core things which needed to be done. Then we implemented lots of missing features which we just discovered when working with the system or when trying to work with the system. So stuff like reference properties, stuff like improving the document tree performance in the backend. We implemented defined implementation in Flow Query so that it works with the current content repository. We started the workspace module, also we started to adjust the workspace module to the content repository, the new one. We kickstarted some command like node repair. And also we did groundwork for import and export in a stable way. And as you see, these kind of topics, they span a whole range of things. We also stabilized quite a lot. So for instance, for last year's state, you still needed to build a custom NEOS UI because we needed some adjustments in some details how the NEOS user interface works. And it was quite a bit of work going into getting rid of that. So that means right now you can actually use a plain NEOS user interface version and it will work with the event source content repository. And the important thing is that this sounds like a small change, but actually this is impacting all of you because we are actually doing that in the master version of the NEOS user interface. So that means that this part needs to be especially well tested, especially stable, and so on. So that's what we took care of, that this actually works out. We also improved the event sourcing core package quite a bit more with all kinds of fixes. Then we did stuff like implement or fix backend caching so that you actually can use the Fusion cache as you want and we get a good performance. Stuff like copy-pasting in the backend make this work. And as you see, it's really lots of small fixes inside the NEOS backend to have a consistent state again. And that brings me to a very important topic. Up to last year, we've pretty much only talked about the event source content repository, which is about 17,000 lines of code right now, including comments. And that is actually quite stable right now, this core layer, and I would say it's basically beta quality. So there haven't been any really big drastic changes in the last year on that. It was just incremental step-by-step improvements. There's a really big test suite there. We have a really high test coverage and these kind of things. So that is in a really good shape. On the other hand, there is another package called Event Source NEOS Adjustments, and that is 14,000 lines of code. And what this actually does is it adjusts NEOS because in a way so that it fits to the new content repository. So that because of the API changes in the lower layer, we need to adjust the upper layer as well. So this package will be merged into the core at some point, and it's also built in a way so that this is actually rather easy. But this is actually where currently most of the bugs happen, so that is alpha quality, I would say. And the good thing, this top level has basically no knowledge of event sourcing or anything in there, or the core how does everything work logic in there, but that's just the normal basically the parts of the NEOS backend in various parts. So that is a part where everybody of you can quite easily and readily help us to make the quality better and to get that out of the ground. We started not just with the demo side, so up until last year, we did everything with the demo side to get up and running. Then we started with more complex projects, like the docs side, for instance, and we figured out we don't want you to rewrite all your Fusion code. That would be a bad idea. So what we're actually doing is we are creating a compatibility layer so that we emulate, for instance, some parts of the Node Context API so that your Fusion code mostly just works as before and it doesn't even notice that it's running with a new content repository. And by now, we've tested that with quite some advanced Fusion code snippets in the wild. And that is just very important, I think, for getting this project off the ground so that the migration path is just as smooth as possible. So that is why we are investing so much in this area. And yeah, here comes one of my favorites. We want to be good citizens in the open source ecosystem. And historically, we just had very small packages which we were able to release and which we have been able to use in other systems, so in Symfony or Laravel, for instance. So we just had smaller utilities where this is actually possible. But in many cases, that's very hard because everything or many classes are tied into the Flow framework, stuff like the dependency injection work system and so on. And it turns out that the world has basically made, so for instance, Symfony has made a big step towards a really, really good dependency injection system, for instance. So that means there is actually no technical reason anymore why something like the content repository would not work in Symfony. We just need to be aware of a few constraints. So for instance, we don't use the flow inject annotations in the code base, but we use constructor injection as an example. But by doing that, we are actually able to create a library which runs even without flow, which actually works, for instance, in Symfony. And for me, that is so important because as you probably guessed by now, the cond repository is a really difficult part in our system, but it's also one of our very unique contributions. And if we can make this more available to other content management systems and other frameworks, we'll also get a lot back at some point. And that is what we hope for. So we hope for reaching out to other communities. We hope for reaching out to other people and other systems. And by that, we can actually make that a really high quality product in the end, I think. And then we also did some fun experiments. For instance, we started a graph database backend for all that. But I'm not elaborating in detail on that. So, as I've quickly mentioned already, we are running with way more realistic examples right now. So, up to last year's conference, we were all running with a demo site. And right now, we are testing it actually with the docs Neos.io website with the event sourced content repository. It is not yet live, so that means it's not yet the version you see on docs Neos.io. But it is still, I think, quite relevant because the doc site is just way more complex. And now is the time where actually I'm able to show you some bits of that. Yeah. Okay. So that is actually the doc site running locally on my laptop, and it is running the event sourced version of that. And I'm now in the front end, and you just basically see no big difference. So the table of contents somehow doesn't render, but besides that, we just see the main menu, we see the first text, and so on. And if we click around, we have somehow varied experiences. So there are pages which really work well like this, but when you scroll down and at some point you see stuff like, oh, there is an exception here. And that is pretty typical for the current state. So many things work, but then there are errors here and there. And if you look into the error, you see that actually that is something with a YouTube embed. And I didn't look into this one in detail now, what the problem is here, but I guess there was some incompatibility in the YouTube package, which we didn't fix yet. So that would be actually something to look into and then to improve the compatibility layer step by step. And that is what we've done in the past, and that is the job we are currently mostly focusing in. And there are also some other pages, for instance, that's the same one. It's also a YouTube error, for instance. And then there are also errors like these ones, which are doing a full stack trace. And this is actually an error of the routing of the system, of flow. And that is one of the difficulties because, for instance, the Node API is so tied into so many parts of Neos and Flow, so for instance, to the URL routing, this all needs to be adjusted a little bit so to work to make it work nicely. So that means routing is one of the parts where we need to invest some more work to make that all really work out and smoothly. And actually, the first call to the content repository, I'm not sure if that's even here in the stack trace, because actually that's all the flow routing defaults, so to speak. So that means that is actually an error which has not much to do with the event sourced content repository, but just, we would have to look in detail there here. So let's look into the backend. So if I'm in the backend of the content repository, I can of my instance, I can modify content as usual. I can save and publish that, or I can discard it just as usual. These basic functions work quite well, but then there are some errors at some point. So for instance, if you drag and drop something, that also works. But so you see it's moved, and if I reload, it's still moved. So actually the move has worked. But we see there is a problem. This publish indicator is not up there, updated. So that's actually a bug. And I'll do something which we don't want to do normally. I want to do some live coding to actually fix that in order to explain to you that it's not rocket science to do that, that everybody can help with it. So What do you actually need to do with that? Let's just open one slide again. La la la. No, this one. Right. So If an error occurs on the write side, then you would see an exception directly when you modify something. So you would see an exception directly when moving. If an error occurs on the read side, you basically see some, you don't see this exception, but you see some kind of not updated thing. So that is what we are currently having, right? So we want to have this publish indicator updated, but it's not updated. So that means the error is actually could be on this part of the site. We can verify this further. I hope that's somehow readable. We can look into the event log. Let's look at the way bottom, blah, blah, blah. Where can I see everything? Let's see. Right. So I'll just open that event. That's actually an event called node aggregate was moved. So that is our node move event. It's a bit hard to see right now, probably. So that means our move event, which we wanted to do, is actually properly stayed in the event store. And as soon as that happened, we know that this should reflect on the read side as well properly. But it turns out it doesn't seem to be the case. So that means we are looking into an error of the projection somehow. So there's one specific projection just handling the count up here. So basically just tracking what has actually changed and counting that together. This is the so-called change projection. I'll just open that. This projection is stored in a database table. And basically we just see, okay, there are somehow six rows in this table. And if I move something, I'll just move something else. So this one, I would expect it to be seven changes now because we actually did something. But you see, if I reload now, it still stays six changes in the table. So that means actually just by observing the system, we are able to limit the scope of our search. So we know actually that the error must be in this change part of the projection. And actually it's this line which we see here, which is not being done. So because we know this, the things are in the event store, they are not in this changes table. So it must be the line in the middle which is actually missing. And this line is implemented in a so-called projector. So that's the so-called change projector. And the basic idea of such a projector is that it is having some methods like this one, when node properties were set, and they're receiving the events from the event store. So that means an event which is persisted in the event stream is sent to all the projectors, and the projector can then do something with it. And for instance, when we change a node property, we are calling this mark as changed method. And what we are actually doing is we are creating or we are inserting something in the database just directly. So I don't want to explain that really step by step, but basically it's just doing a database query saying insert into change and add this one line and remember that this S actually has changed. And we see, here's a markers moved method in here, which is nice, but somehow it's never called. I would say that is a smell. Shouldn't happen. So what we would actually need to do is we would need to create a new method and just make some more space. We need to find out what the event is we actually want to listen on. So we can just globally search for a node move. And we see, so the events are always named in the past tense. So basically was moved, for instance. So we see the third is actually the one we need. Node aggregate was moved is the event which we can just check. A node aggregate was moved in a content stream as defined in the move node mapping. So that means actually that is the storage of changing, of moving. So what we need to do is when node aggregate was moved, we actually need to implement this callback method. Node aggregate was moved event. And what we basically want to do is basically just saying this mark as moved. And what do we need to pass in here? We need to pass in a content stream identifier. So the content stream identifier is roughly something like the workspace. That's something you will learn when you start using that, or we can help with that. We have something like the node aggregate identifier, which is the node identifier basically. And the third one is we need to tell the system in which dimension actually things have moved. And actually, there for that part, we need some small workaround because a moving of a node can actually affect nodes in many dimensions and not just in one. And this is stored in the move node mappings. So we just need to fetch these mappings, and we can just say we'll take the first one, get moved node origin, I think the method is called. And actually, that is some kind of a workaround right now. We simply use the first move node mapping here to find the dimension space point. So, and I'm totally sure that, of course, like if you've never written that before, that kind of style, it will still feel strange to you at first. And actually, you would have not been able to write that. I would have not been able to write that either if I wouldn't have learned about event sourcing and tried that out. But as you see, sometimes these small parts actually can do something. So how can we test that now? We can actually start moving things around. So that's how you would classically do it, right? You would try to reproduce the error and see if it happens again. But if you remember a bit back, what we can also do is we can just replay our projection. And that is a very powerful thing to do. So we can use our command line and say, we want to just replay the change projection. And it just replays everything. And if we check the database table now, we should expect more than 6 rows here. And whoa, 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 there are quite some more in here for all the things we have done. And if we reload our backend, we see, nice, there is a change which should be published here because that is actually our move. And that this way, we can actually publish the move as well. So to circle back, actually, as said, this change is nothing you would be able to write without any introduction. But on the other hand, it's not that hard to learn, so that I think everybody of you will be able to help out there and will be able to do that. So I would go back to my presentation, I think. So I'd like to showcase a bit more how we actually work. So who is we? It's mostly so Bastian, Sebastian. I'm talking about myself, about the third person. No, I shouldn't read and talk. So actually, it's Bastian Weidelich, it's me, and it's Bernhard Schmidt, and Christian and David have also already contributed quite some parts and have actually learned about the concepts in the last years. A really big part, so they also have a good overview about it. And my usual train of working looks like that when working on the event source content repository. I do like 4 hours of coding, then I hit a wall. Then I do 1 hour of thinking, then I need 1 hour of discussing with Bastian usually, or with Christian, or with the others. And then the wall just suddenly dissolved and I have lots of insights. And if I say, let's come in and join us, that's probably something which many people are skeptical about, and I can totally understand that. The important thing to remember is that we actually have these two layers, which I've showed previously. So we have the event source content repository at the bottom layer, and we have the Neos adjustments in the top layer. And the bottom, the event source content repository part, is the one where we need to do these heavyweight discussions, where we really need to think through all the edge cases and these kind of things. But if we work on the top layer, actually, it's mostly reading a stack trace, fixing a condition, trying to understand why, for instance, Fusion doesn't render anything. And in very rare cases, we need to adjust the underlying API. But mostly, it's really, you know, there's an if condition missing somewhere in the adjustments, for instance, these kind of things. And in the top part, I think everybody has the skills to help out, and we are able to onboard a lot of people there. So that's just a shout out to all of you. It would be really cool if you could support us here, and so that we can make it happen easier. So what about the roadmap? So we are currently at the state that we started with a prototype. We started working with the demo site first. We are currently working with the docs.neos.io website, so we're currently in the middle of that process. At some point, we'll probably start with the next website like Neos.io, and then we will start rolling it out to more and more sites and fixing the things along the way. And there's a good article by Norman Nielsen. I'm not sure if you know that. It's called Why You Only Need to Test with 5 Users. And this article has a really nice diagram in there, which looks like that. So on the x-axis, you see the number of test users you actually need. And on the y-axis, you see how many usability problems actually are found. And in this case, it's about a usability study. But I think the same applies basically to technical problems and technical bugs. And the nice sentence below is like, the most striking truth of the curve is that 0 users give 0 insights. So that means we actually need users. And right now we are here. We have 1 user, and that's me. So the other developers who are helping out with the event source content repository are mostly working on the different layers. So Bastian mostly on the API packages and the core, Bernhard and the depth of the graph projection, and I'm mostly running like the end-to-end stuff with the user interface. And we need to be here, so we need to get these 5 users basically. And question is why we didn't manage to do that yet. Actually, we planned to do that in the last year, but there were 2 reasons for that. The first one, of course, is COVID-19. So we were quite good on track until February, but as many of you know, I also have a small boy who's 2.5 years old. And since then, and the kindergarten has closed, I have been working only 4 hours every day instead of my normal 7-hour workday. And as you all, or most of you also know, I'm also co-founder and technology officer at Sandstorm. And I also needed to take care that you know, our business continues running, so I wasn't able to do anything in the event source content repository since COVID-19. Last year, and that's the first reason. The second one is we wanted to do a fundraiser. So last year we said we want to get 50 to 100,000 euros, and we didn't get that organized. Fundraising is not that high on my personal "it makes me happy" list. I actually did that once for the Neos user interface. So if you remember the React user interface, we did the fundraising there. And it was not that hard, but it just took quite some time. You just needed to do quite some phone calls and so on. And actually, people were really receptive about it. So many people wanted to help there. And actually, that is a point where you can really, really well support us, because you don't need any coding skills to do that. It's basically taking a phone and just calling some big customers of Neos, some big agencies of Neos, and basically see that we get this get some of the money would actually really help a lot. So that means 50 to 100,000 euros I think would be useful, and that is still my current view of the world, that would actually speed up things a lot. In the last year, we spent about 10,000 euros from the Neos core team budget, which is, for our Neos core team budget, a lot of money. But for the whole project, as you can imagine, it's not that much. And I personally invested, for instance, a lot of hobby evenings, and I know that the others, so my free time basically, and a lot of the others have been doing the same. So is that all about the money, and is he just begging for money? No, actually not at all. I don't care about money. I want to get this thing done, and I will do that, and I will push that forward regardless of any funding. But on the other side, I can't make any promises on when it's actually done, because that just depends on a lot of factors, and it depends on that I can get enough food and we have our company running and I have time for spending there, and so on and so on. And it also is, of course, so that is the main reason actually. So I think money actually helps to speed up this kind of process. But there are also other ways to speed that up. So that means we could do a fundraiser, but we could also involve the community in more ways in the upper layers, for instance. So there's quite some ways what we can actually do. So please support us helping in the upper layers. How can you actually help yourself? The first important thing is you can go to a Slack channel. It's called Project CR Rewrite, or you just ask in Slack and people will get you redirected to that. That's where we hang out and where we discuss things. It's pretty easy-ish to get started, not as easy as we would like by now, but we will fix that so as soon as the first people have interest there. At latest, so you basically check out a branch of the demo of the docs site, and then you say Composer install, and then you can are up and running. Need two more commands, and then that's it. And actually, I want to do one more shout out for Neo Sprints. I mean, of course, obviously, due to the COVID-19 situation, we can't. We are not organizing any right now, but as soon as we have that done and we can organize sprints again, that is a really, really good. Reason to get to a sprint. And as I said earlier, Michael Gerdemann from AVNC came to our Eventsos sprint here in Dresden in, I think, 2017. And actually, he built the basis of what we've just modified. So he built this change projection. And of course, you know, we discussed things and we did some parts together, but a huge part actually he has done on his own, and he has helped us a lot with that. And I think that is what actually every individual can also do and get that going. Right. So what did we see today? Actually, we've seen the current state of the event source content repository. It's not magically done, but it is improving at a steady pace. I would really love to have more people involved get everything up and running and to a good state. And I'm looking very much forward to getting it done and to see you next time at NEOS conference. It's really good to see you all on the streams, but it will be also really nice to see you in person again at some point. So thank you very much and have a nice conference. Thanks.
And here we are with our live talk today. Thank you very much, Sebastian.
It's bright here. I'm not sure why.
Really?
I wonder whose fault that is. Thank you very much for the insights into the efforts to write the event source content repository. We did have a couple of questions, and we do take a little bit of time to ask them. So David Spora was first, and he asked, can event sourcing be combined with classic models or schemas?
Yes, but you need to be aware of the boundaries. So for an example, in domain-driven design, there's this idea of a context boundary, and this is a pretty important concept. So what is difficult is mixing event sourcing inside one context, but you can easily compose your application of multiple contexts. That means in practice, for instance, we are using event sourcing for like the core data structure of our system. So that means the node tree, the dimensions workspaces, but we don't use it for stuff like users, for instance, or uploaded files, for instance, or I don't know, all the domain sites, so stuff what's also in the NEOS backend. We also don't use it for the node types configuration, for instance, so it's really the core of the system where we are using it and where we are doing that and where it pays off, but it's not all the rest, so to speak. And that's also important. It's not a silver bullet. So you should please do not use event sourcing on every project you are now doing. That's not a good idea, but it's a very good idea to do it at the core of your business where you can benefit from these things a lot. Yeah.
So that for me already answers part of his second question, if there's real world examples that benefit from that. And that was what you just described, where you use event sourcing in certain parts in NIOS where it is beneficial, and in other parts you don't, where it's not necessary to do that, right? Yeah.
So, I mean, there are some real-world examples. They're usually not that well-known, so to speak. So there's one of, I think, Uber? Yeah, I think Uber it is. So they have built some kind of scheduling system based on event sourcing quite intelligently. Funny thing is it's not like advertised as a big event source system. So that's the hard thing about it. Actually, there are quite some examples in the wild, but you cannot just Google for event source CRM and then you find it at the first spot, for instance. But it's rather hidden in the technical implementation if that's actually done. So it's not that easy to find that. We have had some really good experiences in the company with some light versions of that. So, for instance, we had a problem where we actually lost some user data without event sourcing, and where event sourcing helped us, or storing events helped us to recover from that. So, yeah.
All right. And we do have another question from Victor Isak, and he asks, what performance impact would it have if projections were calculated on the fly?
Yeah. So, that is a hard one in the sense that, I mean, the event log contains a lot of things. So if you've seen probably in the demo site, in the site I was running, I had 3,000 something events in there. And that will, of course, grow a lot over time. And it will grow, the longer you use the site, the longer it will become at some point. There is a way to shorten that at some regular intervals, but it would be very, very hard to redo everything, like on every request and every user interaction. I think if you do event sourcing in other kinds of systems, so not based on PHP, but I don't know, based on languages where you actually have a server process running on a long term, you would be able to build something up on the fly, store it in memory, and then access it. That would be certainly somehow possible, though I'm not aware of anybody doing that. So most people actually use projections as some kind of persistent cache, and they actually also store that in a database or in any kind of Redis or Graph or Elasticsearch or whatever. So actually, it's pretty common to build it this way.
Sebastian, thank you very, very much for your talk.
Only live talk.
Yeah.
We've seen some funny comments in Big Blue Button. So we will release the live talk and live fixing bugs on stage clone of Sebastian now. And we will send him back stage where the director clone of Sebastian will take charge of the live stream again. So thank you very much, Sebastian.
Thanks.